Hello, BookTube. I'm back, as promised. I am so out of practice at doing this, and I know some of you have experienced this, so please bear with me. And as you can see behind me and in my last video, I alluded to the background, and most of you have probably figured out by now that I moved. It was a very big move. And so I am trying to find the places in this house that makes sense and work well for recording. So, you know, lighting and just positioning. This time you get my kitchen in the background, just the way it is. there's a few other things back there I guess you can look at besides my kitchen. So anyway, I thought I would just get started here and no matter what, get this out and I'll work out the little details later. And I don't know how much, I'm trying to look at it to see how much glare you're getting off of my glasses. This place, especially this room, gets a lot of light. So that's a good thing, but it can also cause some problems. I have to position myself correctly and put the camera in the correct place so you can see anything. So anyway, I don't want to belabor that too much, but life update, I'm not going to share too much more than I already have. I will say the obvious. I've moved and it was a very big move. We moved to another state, so you know, it wasn't a matter of moving across town. And we hadn't moved in, I'm not even going to say how many decades, but we have no experience moving. So that was fun. So it was quite a big deal. And then there have been other life events that have played into this. Retirement, kind of retirement. I know that's cryptic, but retirement. And let's see what else. There were just some big changes, big life changes. And of course, like many, you know, there were a couple of deaths in the family, and there was, you know, various illnesses and, you know, things like that that just disrupt, you know, what your plans. You know, when we make plans, we don't always get to stick with our plans. So I just didn't have it in me to make videos. I tried to hang in there as much as I could, just participating when and where I could, commenting on your videos. I've been on Instagram some, and I've posted. So if you haven't found me on Instagram, I'm Terry Talks Books on Instagram. And it was something I could do, something that was fairly easy for me to do in order to keep participating and talking to you all. So I will try to be back for more than just, you know, one or two videos, but I really honestly cannot promise anything, just that I will try my best. And things are still, yeah, there's still things, you know, shifting and, you know, and moving and change, you know, just changes happening all around. So we'll see what can happen. One of the things I don't do, I'm just too old to do this kind of thing, but I only, you know, if something is not, I don't want to say not fun, but if something is becoming a burden to me, I will redirect my energies and not do that thing. And I don't want this to be a burden. So if it was becoming a bit burdensome just because of life issues, so anyway, I will try to hang in there. That is 4 minutes of life update. So hopefully that caught you up enough. I did miss you all. Anyway, why I'm really here today, forgive the voice, I'm not sure what's going on there, but why I'm really here today is that I want to talk a little bit about, you know, a bit of a 2022 wrap-up, reading wrap-up, and a 2023 kind of plans. Goals, that my goals are usually pretty loose anyway. So again, I you know, I don't want this to become something that feels like a chore to do. So I'm very careful at trying to keep that from happening. So if I build in flexibility to any of my plans in this area, and just kind of flex with however I need to flex to make it work for me. So let's see here. In 2022, I participate in the Goodreads reading challenge. And so, you know, if you've participated, you know that you set a number of books that you want to read for the year. And I've had to cut back in the last couple of years. I just knew that realistically I wasn't going to read at my normal pace, which was, somewhere between 70 and 80 books a year. I know some people read a lot more than that. That's not me. I don't do that. And some people read a lot less than me. You know, I've said to some of my non-reader friends, I don't want to say non-reader because they read, but if they read 6 books in a year, or maybe even 12 books in a year, they to them, that's a lot of books to read. And so, you know, if I tell them, you know, I read 70 books, you know, they just look at me like that's insane. So I kind of feel that way a little bit. Some of you are reading like 200 books a year. I was like, how do you even do that? So to each his own reading pace or desire, how much you want to read. One of the reasons I don't read that many is, you know, in the 100, 200 range is, I'm not sure I could even do that. But without making them all super, super easy short reads. But I like to dwell on what I've read at least a little bit. And as it is, I feel, you know, I don't do that enough. And so that's one reason why I keep it in the range that I do. So the last couple of years, it's been, you know, half what I normally do, which I've just talked about. And this year was, I think, 36. I finished my last book of the year last night, about 10 p.m. So 36 books. And I am quite pleased with that, quite honestly. It's considering, you know, just the lack of focus when you've got big life changes happening and just the life update I just gave you, I didn't even detail it, but you know, it was just the kind of things that didn't leave me with a whole lot of energy to focus, or just the focus just wasn't there. So I'm quite pleased with that 36 books, to be honest. Let's see here. I did manage a few buddy reads in the last year, 2 years. Maybe even 3 years. They've been fairly restricted, but I have done them. I think, was it 2 years ago? I did the Louise Erdrich author spotlight with Britta Bowler. And any of these things I've mentioned, you know, people, Instagram accounts, YouTube accounts, things like that. Why am I waving? I don't know. I will link those below, and the links may be a bit delayed because of the way I'm going to probably be uploading this. So, but I will get those in there. So anyway, Britta Bowler, we did that, and then last year we swept up. Did it bleed into 2022? It might have. I didn't check on that, but there was a new book. Erdrich had a new book out last year, and we the sentence. I think, and we did read that kind of as an addendum to what we'd already done. And I may have my years off. It might've been 20 and 21. And then 22 is this one loner book. The last few years have been a blur. Let me tell you, most of you can probably say the same thing. So there was that. And then I participated on Instagram, which you might hear me refer to as Bookstagram once in a while. It's kind of like BookTube, only for Instagram. And I did participate in my, a little bit half-baked way, in a challenge called TBR 22 in 22. So if you go on Instagram and you use the hashtag TBR22in22. That's the one for last year that I participated in. That is headed up by Jillian. I think that's how you say her first name. I've just read it. I'm assuming it's Jillian. And Dumas? I'm not sure how she pronounces it. That's her name. And I will link her Instagram account below. I think it's Jillian, G-I-L-I-O-N-C Dumas, D-U-M-A-S. But she also has a blog. And I think she and I have been following each other for over 10 years, probably. Rose City Reader. So if you want to, if you like to check out book blogs, and there's still some out there. I still have one. I haven't been posting to it. I keep considering going back and posting to it. Haven't done so yet. Same reasons as above. But her blog is Rose City Reader, and so she links to things there, talks about things there, sets up challenges there, so the you can maybe participate more fully through the blog. But I just used the hashtag in Instagram and tagged her as well, and that seemed to work just fine. Let's see here. And in her Instagram account, she does have a Linktree link, so if you go to her bio, click on Linktree, you'll find links to all of the places she's found online. So the other thing I did was, this bleeds over into my plans for 23. I'll go ahead and talk about it. This is going to be a mess. I am so out of practice. So I'm going to be participating in TBR 23 and 23. Anyway, so this challenge, which I didn't tell you what it was, but you may have guessed, is basically to read your shelves. So if you've had a book on your shelf since before January 1st on whatever year we're in, so this year it will be any book on my shelf before 2023, I can use. So it's the To Be Read shelf, TBR 23, 23 books in 23. So this goes along with something that I've been doing for the last few years anyway, which is to basically read my shelves. I have thousands of books, and I don't really know at the moment how many I have that are unread. I could toss a figure out, and it's astonishingly high. And I don't want to have, I'm a reader more than a book collector, even though I do kind of collect some books and I don't get rid of everything. But it hurts a little bit to say how many I've collected over the years that I really even still want to read that I've never read. So for the last few years, I've really made it a priority that my actual goal is to read my shelves. It doesn't mean I never buy a new book or, you know, go outside of that, but my primary goal, whatever that looks like, whether it's participating in this TBR challenge, whatever it is to read the things that are on my shelves. So this will help me do that. And that is, as I just said, major goal for 2023, just like it has been 2022, 2021, 2020. I was probably even focusing on 2019 on that. I'm not sure when I stated it as a goal and just decided focus on that. So that is pretty much that. I will come back to my goals. Like I said, this is messy. I'm bouncing all over and blending my categories. Okay, so back up, one of the things I did in 2022, and it will carry over into 2023, is for Victober this year, I was reading Morning and Evening by Charles Spurgeon. So he is a Victorian preacher. And these are devotionals, and this particular copy that I have is the his language as he wrote it. There are updated language, you know, for the modern reader kind of thing, because this was written in the 1800s. I don't have a problem with that. In fact, I prefer it, quite honestly. to read it the way he wrote it, with all the these, thous, and thys, and thines, and whatever else. So anyway, and it's laid out like this. We have a morning and an evening. And so I've been reading out of that, and I started it in October. Rainy from Rainy Day Reads mentioned it, and so I decided I was going to do that as well, and picked this up and started it in October as my Victober read, because I wasn't really able to participate more fully in Victober. I had something else going on that I will talk about in a little bit, what I was reading. And it wasn't Victorian. It was older, but not Victorian. So I decided to do that as my Victober reads. And so since I started in October, I'm going to continue. I'm back in January, and I'm going to at least go through up till October. And I may just go ahead and repeat through the end of the year. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see when I get there. See how I feel about that. So back to my notes. Did that. Classics. Okay, since I'm going to talk about classics that I want to read, I want to finally get around to reading, I will mention what I was reading instead of Victorian reads. In October, I was reading this book here, which has been on my shelf. It qualified for TBR 22 and 22, and it was a buddy read, and it's been on my shelves for a long time. This was approximately 700 pages of teeny, tiny, itty bitty print. Oh my goodness. I wish my copy had a little bit bigger print, but it didn't. So, The Mysteries of Udolpho by Anne Radcliffe. Now, long ago I read The Italian by Anne Radcliffe, and had picked this up almost immediately after reading that decades ago, and never got it read. So I finally read it. I finally read this book. And I have to say, I didn't always enjoy it. Enjoyment is not really the word for some books. I'm glad I read it. And there were parts that amused me. There were parts that bored me. Parts that made me roll my eyes. It's like, how much nature worship, I'll just word it that way, nature worship and opining on the sublime, whether it's nature or God or whatever it is, you know, after a while, it's like, okay, I get it. You know, so kind of that kind of thing. And okay, can we get to the plot? Can we get to the squeaky doors and castle, spooky castle bit? You know, this is Gothic. This is Gothic romantic. I can't even remember now. I'd have to go review my notes. But there's a Gothic element to this, and there is some Gothic tropes in there, but not really super sensationalist type. You know, there wasn't a lot of ghosts popping out of nowhere, but there were mysteries. So, and they all had explanations to them. So anyway, the atmosphere was very Gothic in many ways. So that I could go into a big long discourse, and I'm not going to, but anyway, finally read that. And I read that with Britta Bowler. So that was one of our buddy reads. And, it was one of my classics that I wanted to get read, and it was one of my TBR 22 and 22s. So I got it off my shelves. So let's see. Can I finally start talking about 2023 exclusively? Maybe, kind of. Let's see. So my plans to read my shelves, to participate in TBR 23 and 23, which really helped me to stay focused on that. And hopefully I'll read more than 23 of things on my shelves. And let's see. So classics. I have a lot of classics. And I have two I'm going to hold up that I have wanted to read for a very, very long time. Where did I put them? Very, very, very long time. And you've probably heard me talk about this before. David Copperfield. Okay. I have said I'm going to read this every year for the last, I don't know how many years. I'm finally going to get to this and read it. Now, here's the thing. I have read this before. I was 8 years old when I read this. I do have some memories of it. I do remember some things about it, and I have some images, and it'll be curious for me to go back and see how my memory works. And it might not be a faulty memory so much as, you know, an 8-year-old perspective versus a, I'm not going to tell you how old I am now, but you can see all the gray hair perspective. So that was a very, very, very long time ago that I read this. And the copy I had was had print in it, like my Anne Radcliffe book that I just showed you, that teeny tiny stuff. And this is an even bigger book. Okay, this one was 700 pages-ish. And then there's David Copperfield. Pages are bigger, and yet there's more there. I don't know how many pages I've got to read in this, but it's big. So I have been saying forever that I'm going to read this. So this is on the top of my stack of classics that I want to get read. It will also fulfill the TBR 23 and 23. This copy has not been on my shelves. I guess it would be okay because I did purchase this last year because it prints a little bit bigger, not a lot, but it's a little bit bigger than what I had. And I just thought, I just cannot read that teeny tiny print for that many pages. So I really want to get to that. Okay. I really, really do. So if you notice me not reading it and it's towards the end of the year, tell me, ask me, have you read that yet? So hopefully I will do that earlier in the year. Just start working on it. The first one I want to read though this year, and this has been on my shelf for a little while, and I do enjoy Elizabeth Gaskell, is Cranford. I have not actually read Cranford. So I want to get to this, and it's not, shouldn't be too bad. It's not too long. So I think I'll enjoy that. And I would like to read that, start it maybe in January, and just finish it when I finish it. I think it's, I might be able to put it down and pick it back up over a month or two. My understanding is a lot of the things in here are like little vignettes. So that's another classic I want to read. And let's see what else. And this one here I've never gotten around to reading is Wuthering Heights. Just haven't read it. I seem to know all about it because, I mean, are there people who don't know about Wuthering Heights? One of the things I know about this is people, I don't know if they mistake it for a romance or, you know, their expectation is that they're getting a romance or something like that. I think people either love or hate this. And I think one of the things that contributes to the hate or dislike is that it doesn't turn out to be what the person expected it to be. And there's some really despicable characters, or at least one. I haven't read it. I need to read it. So I really want to get to this one, and that'll fit in nicely because I've read several other Brontes, and there's not so many Brontes that I can't read all the Brontes. And Emily, Charlotte, and the one that I'm not going to remember because I'm sitting here in front of my camera, but y'all know and can look it up if you don't. So anyway, but it wouldn't be too hard to read through those, and so I would like to do this one this year too. And then this one's another big chunk of a book, chunkster as we used to call them, Middlemarch by George Eliot. This is kind of sitting in here as a representative of what I want to read as far as pulling things off my shelf in classics. Some George Eliot. I'm trying to work through reading George Eliot, and so far I've only read one. So I would like to, Silas Marner. And so I would like to read the others. I enjoyed it very much, And I think that, and I've read some about George Eliot, the author. I really think I will enjoy it in the sense that I this is an author I think I should read. That there's some things there that, you know, I think I will be very glad that I've read. So hopefully this one. If not, I've got several others to choose from. I might go back and see what has been read. I mean, what order the books have been written in, and maybe go in order, because this author has a kind of a line where what she wrote prior to that line is different than what she wrote afterwards. So there's that. And I need to pick up the pace. This is getting very long. Okay, what else? Nature books to read. I want to hit up some of my nature books. I have quite a few of those. And on the top of my list is one that's been sitting around for a long time, a very long time. Very long is correct. When was this? Terry Tempest Williams. I love her writing. I love, love, love her writing. And she kind of blends some things. This was copyright 2016. So I ran out, had to buy it. This lovely book, The Hour of Land, because I like Terry Tempest Williams. I love to read her writing. And did I get it read? No. So I really want to finally get this read. And the subtitle, A Personal Topography of America's National Parks. Now I will talk, since this is getting really long, I will talk more about what I like about Terry Tempest Williams when I pick it up and come and talk to you about that. Okay, so there's that. And then I think I want to start with Under the Sea Wind by Rachel Carson. I have two Rachel Carson books here. So Under the Sea Wind, okay, and then one that I meant to read a bazillion years ago, Silent Spring. So this, I don't know which one to read first. I mean, if you have an opinion on that, please let me know. For a couple of reasons, I'm tending towards this one here. I think we've got some seabirds in here, and I have a fondness for birds, which I'll talk about another time. And you can see it's a little bit slimmer. But if you really think this should be read first, let me know. Silent Spring. I'm catching a glare on the books, aren't I? So let me know what you think about that. But those are both on my list. I prefer to read both of them this year, but I'll be happy if I read one. And then another one that I've had on my shelves for quite a long time is John Wesley Powell, The Exploration of the Colorado River and Its Canyons. And you can see this is, I do believe, just a record of his explorations of the Colorado River and its canyons, as the subtitle says. And I, if you've been around any length of time, you know I have a love of the American Southwest and done some studies in that area. And I always said that if I was going to go out and get my PhD in American Studies, that I'd like to focus on the American West. I would, so, but hey, I don't need that piece of paper. I can do it anyway, right? So, might even write some things, who knows? And then, because of that love, there's two other books that I have on my list. Pardon me, while I haven't figured out where to put everything yet. Okay, I have two more books here. I have Dodge City. It's about Wyatt Earp and Bat Masterson and the Wickedest Town in the American West by Tom Clavin or Clavin. It's been on my shelves for a little bit. It's not too terribly old, but it's been a couple of years. So would love to read that. And the other one, I think I picked this one up first. Tombstone, same author. Tombstone, The Earp Brothers, Doc Holliday, and The Vendetta Ride from Hell. So I would like to read both of those, and they look like something I could get through probably fairly quickly, because I think it would interest me so much. You know, sometimes these nonfiction books can be a learning, you know, a learning experience, but quite entertaining at the same time. And they're not written super academically, you know, with, I haven't checked. There are some footnotes I see, some notes. But I can get hung up on footnotes. I feel obligated to read them. Okay, yeah, not too many footnotes. And I'm assuming he's probably got a good bibliography in the back. Oh yeah. So it's not without its academic what's the word I'm looking for? Not appeal, anyway, elements. It's not without those, but they don't take over, I guess, is what I would want to say. Anyway, I am starting to kind of lose it here because I'm not used to doing this anymore. But I will say that one of the things that has inspired me to get back into my, you know, to read some of the nature books on my shelf. I'm not participating in the book club, but Heidi and Doris, so Doris Sander, I'd have to look. Forgive me, Doris, if you see this. And Heidi, I think I know her last name or her handle. I will link these two people below and their YouTube channels. But they do the Book Naturalist Book Club, and they've done it for a couple of years now. And this one, I think, was on it last year or the year before. This one here might have been on it as well. But anyway, they kind of inspired me to, you know, go pick up some of these books. I have them on my shelves. I enjoy, you know, nature writing. You could call some of it environmentalist writing. Some of them are quite the blend of different elements. For instance, Terry Tempest Williams, it's one thing I could talk about, I guess, in the future, is her writing, and she blends in environmentalism in a way that I can tolerate reading. I'll explain that later, at a later time. So you can just have that sitting there waiting for an explanation in the future. Give me something to talk about. Anyway, that's my messy wrap up for 2022 and my kind of plans for 2023, and able to show you some of the books that are on my shelves that I would really like to read this year without getting into too many. Probably one of the first books I'll read this year is, I forgot to mention this, Tana French, Broken Harbor, and this will be a buddy read. So for January, so that should get read like right up front. So this is actually on my stack and I didn't talk about it. So I will end here, and because it'll probably take hours to upload as it is. Anyway, it's been fun. I hope that wasn't too messy for y'all, and I will try to get back in better practice and try not to be too rambly. I ramble. Let's just face it, I ramble. So I will see you again, and I look forward to your comments, and I look forward to seeing your videos, and if you make them. And I thank you all. I had some lovely comments on my 2-minute, 3-minute video from the other day coming back and saying hi. And I appreciate everybody. I can't believe it. Y'all are just still there. That's so nice of you. Thank you so much. You are all a blessing. Thank you. I will talk to you later. Bye-bye.